I'd like to welcome everyone to the afternoon session. This morning, we heard about law and institutions, and as Helen Ingram said, the third important part is science. So we're going to be hearing about science and the future of the Arctic region. And I would like to welcome our first speaker, Dr. Donald Gautier. He's a geologist from the Energy Resources Program of the United States Geological Survey. Thank you.
A persistent theme in the morning's conversations concerned preparedness and, in particular, the possible consequences of development pressures from exploration and development of petroleum in the Arctic. Indeed, the subject of our concern here is preserving the environment of the Arctic region. The development pressure. For exploration and production of petroleum will not come uniformly. It will not come randomly. In the face of demand, the highest pressures will be in those places where the likelihood of significant resources exists. So for the next 30 minutes or so, I'm going to try to summarize for you a project that we have been working on at the U.S. Geological Survey to attempt to quantify the uncertainty concerning the quantities, distribution, and quality of undiscovered, that is yet to find, petroleum resources north of the Arctic Circle. I'm going to begin just to get you in the mood and try to frame this in an international, a global context. I'm going to begin by talking a little bit about, just summarizing a little bit about sort of the pressures in the world today for energy resources. A couple of words about Arctic warming, and then we'll go into the results of this study. How much oil might be in the Arctic, how much undiscovered natural gas might be in the Arctic, and finally, a summary towards the end, depending on how time goes. I will try to put in a few words about some specific cases that I think might have some points of interest for you, and then we'll if there's time, I'll say a few things about development costs. Well, since the Second World War, in particular, we've seen an order of magnitude increase in the production and consumption of energy. Almost all, the vast majority of that increase in production and consumption has been in fossil fuels, no question about it. So this enormous increase is really at the heart of this concern we're discussing. At the same time, what we're seeing is a continuation of this growth in the human population. Most of this growth is going to continue to come in the developing countries, and even a conservative extrapolation suggests that by the middle of this century, there will probably be more than 9 billion of us on this planet, many of whom will have seen television shows that suggest to them that they want to live just like those people in Orange County. In the United States, various energy sources are not evenly distributed. They're not used evenly. In particular, transportation is almost entirely supported by petroleum, whereas electricity generation comes from a variety of sources, but predominant among those is coal, which of course is responsible for the highest concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Before I go any further, I need to say I'm absolutely required. I can't avoid saying a few words about nomenclature because the terms are used quite loosely and it really matters. When we talk about in-place resources, we're talking about the state of nature. When we talk about recoverable resources, which is the principal subject of my study, we're talking about that which can be physically, mechanically produced using existing technology. At the bottom down here, economic resources, this is equivalent to proved reserves. It's very different from mechanically recoverable or in place. It means that there is infrastructure in place. You actually have a marketplace where you can sell the resource. And that's what I'm going to say talk about in just for the next couple of minutes or so. Currently, reserves of oil, that is those economically producible reserves of oil, proved reserves, stand near an all-time high. They've risen significantly in recent years. if you add in these oil sands from the Athabasca sands from Alberta, the number jumps up to something close to 1,400 billion barrels of proved reserves of petroleum. We're currently using about 30 as a world. The world currently uses about 30 billion barrels a year. The expectation is that global demand is going to increase. Sometime during 2008, the trillionth barrel of petroleum was produced. Now, the expectation is that demand for petroleum is going to increase over the next decades. That increase is expected to come mostly in developing countries, particularly China, the Middle East, and India, is where everybody believes they're going to be building cars and driving those cars and using petroleum. That trend is going to be offset somewhat by conservation and all these various activities we talk about in California, the rest of the United States, in Europe, trying to drive more efficient cars, being more careful about what we do. But no matter what we do in these countries, we probably cannot offset the expected increases in demand in these developing countries. It would take some other sort of a breakthrough that we can talk about in a moment. So right now, the current trends suggest the following, that we're looking towards significant population growth. At present, something like 2 billion people rely on so-called traditional fuels, dung and wood, solid fuels for fuel. Call those, something like 1.5 billion people are living on less than $1 a day. About 70% of those are women. As of 2009, for the first time in human history, most people lived in cities. And energy use, because of this urbanization, energy use is increasing more rapidly than the population. Coal, in spite of what we're doing in California, coal is globally the fastest growing energy source and is the largest contributor of carbon dioxide. The expectation is that fossil fuels will continue to dominate global energy use for many decades in the future unless there were a multilateral international effort to address that or there were significant technological breakthroughs. Barring those two events, this is the world we're facing. One of the consequences of all of us humans running around, of course, as we've heard multiple times today, is that we're facing a polar sea, which is probably going to become seasonal in the not too distant future. For those creatures that depend on sea ice, that means the habitat basically goes away. For those creatures who are interested in trade and transportation and development and access, well, that means access becomes ever easier and all of the development pressures that go with that, of course. So our question, though, is, and what we're talking about here today, is how much petroleum might be found in the Arctic, and where might it be? From the point of view of petroleum, you've seen a view similar to this earlier today, so I don't have to go through it from scratch, but in case you haven't been spending the last 5 or 6 years of your life looking at the Earth from a North Polar projection, the center of the view here is the North Pole, the famous Lomonosov Ridge, for the flag planting ceremony, of course. Greenland is to the upper right. The beautiful fjords of Norway are in here. Novaya Zemlya, which we'll talk more about later, is here. The vast expanse of Arctic Russia. Here is northern Alaska here in the Brooks Range, the Arctic Islands of Canada. From a resource point of view, you can think of it as basically three roughly similar area parts. There is dry land, which has had more or less some petroleum exploration over a number of decades. There has been at least some exploration in most of the land areas. There's the deep sea out here, the Canada Basin, the Amerasia Basin, Eurasia Basin, where geologically it's quite unlikely that there will be significant petroleum accumulations. There's been quite a lot of exploration going on in the Arctic. About 400 oil and gas fields have been found already, accounting for about 40 billion barrels of recoverable oil. Remember, about 30 billion a year is what we use in the world. They found about 1,140 or so trillion cubic feet of natural gas. The world uses about 110 trillion a year. Nearly all of these discoveries have been onshore, and the vast majority of it is in two places, the Arctic part of the West Siberian Basin in Russia and the North Slope in Alaska. I should say, when I say Arctic, I'm specifically meaning north of the Arctic Circle, so that's a little different from what some other speakers have been saying. Well, the goals of our Circumarctic Resource Appraisal, or CARA, was the following. A set of probabilistic estimates of yet-to-find, undiscovered oil and gas accumulations. It's a geologically based study. We tried to use one methodology and apply it consistently everywhere, regardless of country boundaries, regardless of oceanic depths or the presence of ice. We looked at everything north of the Arctic Circle, but we only looked at conventional oil and gas. So there's no coal bed methane, there's no hydrates, there's no shale gas, there's no heavy oil. So it's kind of the traditional subject of the oil patch. And we're currently working on the problem of the resource cost relationships there, which I may say more about later. As I said earlier, the subject of this assessment was what we call mechanically producible, technically recoverable resources. That is what you can get out with existing technology, but without regard to price at this point. I'm not going to talk about the methodology here, really. I recommend, if you're interested in getting into it, it's a little bit geeky. I would refer you to start with this article we published in Science. It came out in May of 2009. And so I recommend for methodology, start there. The starting point for the study was a new geological map of the Arctic done together with quite a large and interesting international group of scientists. We put together a new map of the sedimentary basins of the Arctic. Sedimentary basins are where oil and gas may be found. On the basis of that map, we subdivided the Arctic into geologically contiguous similar areas from the point of view of resources, and then we did an analysis, a geologically based analysis of each of them. This map, again the North Polar projection, shows these little subsets of the Arctic. You'll hear me call them assessment units, but that's just this unique volume of rock that we are doing the analysis of. The first question you have to ask is there any resource there at all? Because the places have not been explored, there is a fundamental uncertainty. This map shows our assessment units color-coded by probability for the existence of at least one accumulation greater than minimum size. Those assessment units, those sedimentary basins of the Arctic, where discoveries have been made, and where we see it as virtually certain there are additional discoveries, are in this darkest blue color. So for example, the Sverdrup Basin of Canada, the North Slope of Alaska, the West Siberian Basin, those are places that are colored the darkest color because there have been big, significant discoveries there. So what did we find? First of all, and this is quite important for the consideration of this group, I think, is that about 90% of the undiscovered resources, the yet-to-find resources, are probably under the continental shelves. That means they're not out in the area under consideration by the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. They're up under settled, sovereign territories. That said, we estimate with about a 90% confidence interval that there is between about 44 billion barrels and about 157 billion barrels of oil undiscovered everywhere north of the Arctic Circle. Now, there's a mean estimate of about 90 billion barrels. That would represent, in our judgment, something like 10 or 15% of the conventional oil remaining to be found in the world. Not already found, but remaining to be found anywhere in the world. And it constitutes something less than 5% of the total conventional oil endowment. You know, the Arctic, I think, north of the Arctic Circle is about 6% of the Earth's surface. 60% of that undiscovered oil, in our view, is in just 7 of these assessment units, 7 out of these 49. And about 30% of that is in northern Alaska. There are 8 assessment units where we think there's a 50-50 chance of a supergiant field, which means where there is intense pressure for development. Interestingly, the largest, in our judgment, undiscovered field is somewhere between 1 and 7 billion barrels of recoverable oil. Now, the importance of that is that that is significantly smaller than Prudhoe Bay Field, which is the largest oil field in the Arctic now. It means that in our judgment, there is not another Prudhoe Bay Field anywhere in the Arctic. So there's not some bonanza sitting out into Lomonosov Ridge, which will change the world compared to what's going on in the Middle East. Well, here is our map, color-coded, for undiscovered petroleum. And you see that these colors indicate places where discoveries, in our view, could probably be made and developed. And you see it covers a wide area of the Arctic. But it's by no means evenly distributed. And in fact, we find that just a few of these assessment units carry the largest volumes of these recoverable resources. And there one can reasonably expect that is where the development pressure will come. The Alaska platform, the Mackenzie Delta here on the U.S.-Canada border, West Greenland, the Northeast Greenland Shelf, the South Barents Basin, mostly but not entirely in Russian territory, Yenisei-Hotanga, which is kind of a eastward extension of the West Siberian Basin. Those are the places where we think have the greatest potential for undiscovered conventional petroleum. Standing out here, and I think this is relevant to this group, is that that northern Alaska jumps out as sort of head and shoulders above everything else in the Arctic as the single area which has the highest potential for undiscovered conventional petroleum. That translates into the highest development pressure. Here's a map showing
Northern
those
Alaska
assessment
and the Mackenzie Delta,
where we think
are
number
50-50
one for us.
Chance
of West Greenland,
of a
Northeast Greenland,
oil
and
field.
The Barents Sea.
These are
the places
where
we think
where
intense
the
development
is.
Can be expected. Of course, for many in this group, Alaska is the most important thing. Oil has been known in Alaska for many, many years. It seeps out naturally from the ground. Prudhoe Bay was discovered in the 60s, I believe. Prudhoe Bay Field is the largest oil field in the Arctic. It is the largest oil field in North America. It's a very important supplier of petroleum to the lower 49 states. It's a major source of revenue for the citizens of Alaska, including the native peoples. So far, about 15 billion barrels have been produced, and about 7 billion barrels are in reserve. Production in northern Alaska is in steep decline. There is a level at which this declining production reaches when it is no longer economically feasible to run petroleum through the Trans-Alaska pipeline, and you have to shut it in. So there's a great deal of pressure to back up this production. Here's northern Alaska, the area we're talking about. You can see the Brooks Range here, the foothills, and the coastal plain. The development so far has almost entirely been located around Prudhoe Bay Field here. Here you can see the Trans-Alaska pipeline going off here like this. In our judgment, the greatest potential for undiscovered petroleum anywhere in the Arctic is in the Mackenzie Delta, this Beaufort-Mackenzie area, across the Beaufort Sea, and over here in the Chukchi Sea. If you had asked our group doing this analysis where our favorite place to bet on very large oil accumulations would be, we would have said the Chukchi Sea, in that area where Shell spent all that money for those leases. So they evidently came to the same conclusion. Moving along now
for
to
many
West
years
Greenland. It's been known that, again, oil seeps to the surface along the west coast of Greenland. That has encouraged people to do a lot of looking there. The geology is consistent with the significant accumulations. And so over a number of years, a lot of work's been done. The Geological Survey of Denmark and Greenland, the Geological Survey of Canada have demonstrated that, in fact, there is significant petroleum potential there. There were some wells drilled, a couple of wells drilled in the 90s, but very significantly, just in the last few months, Cairn Energy drilled a well offshore West Greenland, and they made a discovery out there. The exact magnitude of that discovery has not been announced, but it was a big deal. The context is that Greenland, of course, is Danish territory, a very strong home rule government. They have a great desire for financial independence. This is one thing the Danes and the Greenlanders really agree on, is they would like to be independent of one another. The Greenland Authority has embraced the ideal of oil exploration, and they're running lease sales in West Greenland and Northeast Greenland, which is quite remote and quite ice-choked. And as I said, Cairn made a discovery here. I don't personally know the exact magnitude of that discovery, but it means that there will basically be an enormous development pressure for development of petroleum offshore West Greenland. Moving along to Norway, we heard a little bit about Norway today. Norway is quite a lovely country. It has one of the world's, if not, depending on how you measure it, but it has one of the very highest standards of living in the world. They have very strict environmental regulations. The oil patch people gripe that you have to wash every tool with baby soap, you know, before you put it in the Barents Sea, but it means they're careful. Oil and gas are crucial sources of income to the Norwegians. The Norwegians are very careful environmentally, a relatively low per capita carbon footprint, unless you count all of the oil and gas that they export. Norway had a very active leasing program since the 60s, when big oil discoveries were made in the North Sea. Oil and gas has basically run much of the Norwegian economy, and they have busied themselves leasing out much of the Norwegian continental shelf, including the Barents Sea. The Norwegian Barents has been under a lot of pressure. There's been drilling up there, a number of wells drilled, some discoveries have been made, but the discoveries in the Barents have been disappointing for the Norwegians, because they found sort of gas and liquids, but they haven't really found the big oil accumulations they were looking for. The one exception to that, and I should point to this, that the problem in Norway is that oil production reached a maximum here in the early 2000s, and it has begun a steep decline, which is exerting an enormous economic pressure on the Norwegians. They would very much like to see some additional oil production. The one place remaining, the area of overlapping claims between Russia and Norway, is essentially an unexplored area, but geologically, the geology suggests the possibility of extremely large accumulations out there, and therefore that's one of the strong drivers for the Russians and the Norwegians to reach an agreement, because everybody would like to see what is under these big structures out there. It's probably not oil, but it's probably gas and liquids. Moving along now to undiscovered natural gas. This is quite different from oil in the Arctic. Whereas the oil in the Arctic will have a big impact on individual countries, undiscovered natural gas in the Arctic contributes at a global scale. It's a significant part of the undiscovered gas resource in the world is in the Arctic. We estimate between about 800 trillion cubic feet and about 3,000 trillion cubic feet of undiscovered conventional gas exists north of the Arctic Circle. Those are very large numbers. Remember, global consumption is about 100 or 110 TCF a year. It says to us geologically, as they say in the oil patch, the Arctic is gas prone. Volumetrically, on a BT, on a energy unit level, there's roughly three times as much gas as there is oil north of the Arctic Circle, and more importantly, the expectation is for much larger accumulations of gas than for oil, and therefore, given the gas market, there would be great pressure to develop these gas resources in the Arctic. About 30% of the global undiscovered conventional gas in the world, in our opinion, probably exists in a very small fraction, a few percent or less, just a percent or so, of the Earth's surface, especially in these few assessment units that we're talking about with this great development potential. So it suggests to us that gas is more of a development pressure in the Arctic, ultimately would be more of a development pressure in the Arctic than will oil. And most of that gas is in Russian territory. Here's our map. Having said that about the Russian territory, it's also true that there are widespread opportunities for discovery of conventional natural gas all over the Arctic. I would point to just a few of these assessment units which really jump out at us. The South Kara Sea, which is basically the offshore extension of the West Siberian Basin. The South and North Barents Sea, almost entirely in Russian territory, except the westernmost edge of the South Barents Basin is in Norway now with this agreement. And of course, our Alaska platform is another place where a great deal conventional gas might be found, and therefore, when the time comes, there will be development pressure for producing that gas. There are a number of places around the Arctic where very, very large gas accumulations could in principle be found. Yenisei-Hatinga, the South Kara Sea, North and South Barents Basin, Northeast Greenland, West Greenland, the Lena River Delta, and of course, Northern Alaska, among others. Now, Russia is already very rich in gas. Just to kind of put this in context, I've plotted here the 25 or so largest conventional gas fields in the world. These are discovered fields in the world. The first two, these two circles here, are actually two sides of one preposterously large gas field that straddles the border of Qatar and Iran. On one side it's called South Pars, on the other side it's called North Field. if you move on beyond South Pars Northfield, then all of these squares here are gas fields in Russia. So all of these squares represent the world, those of the world's largest gas fields, which are in Russia. And all the squares that I've colored blue are gas fields in Russia that are north of the Arctic Circle. So these are gas accumulations in the Russian Arctic. Russia, of course, is an interesting place. It's a place that cannot be ignored. Its economy depends to a considerable extent on the export of oil and gas. Resources are seen. Dr. Putin himself, I think, has devoted a life to thinking about how one might use resources as a part of a political component of one's intersection with the rest of the world. Russia is the world's number one gas producer, and much of that gas is produced in the Arctic. As we've heard earlier, it's the principal exporter of natural gas to Europe, and from time to time we see ruffles about this as discussion comes up about limiting exports into Europe. So it's quite important. Our study says that the undiscovered natural gas in Russia is going to further reinforce this resource dominance of the Russian Federation. The Russians are rich in gas now, and they're going to be richer in gas over the coming decades as demand comes up. A few words in summary, then, as I reach the end here. Number one, I'd say the Arctic is gas prone, roughly three times as much gas as oil, and much more than that if you look at it from an economic development pressure point of view, because of the very large fields that might be out there. The South Kara Sea is the outstanding place for natural gas, undiscovered natural gas, and therefore the highest developmental pressure. Alaska offshore, in particular the Beaufort and the Chukchi Seas, probably have more development pressure on them for the development of oil than any other place anywhere in the Arctic. And so it isn't just a random thing that Shell has spent $3 billion out there that they are lobbying hard to drill wells. It's because this is just about the best place in the world they could look. Okay? Most other places in the world, these big international oil companies are basically cut out because it's been taken over by national companies. So this is very important from their point of view. Other areas, of course, have oil prospects as well. The Mackenzie Delta, the Barents Sea, East and West Greenland. No matter what they do for this undiscovered Arctic oil, it's not going to shift the global balance away from the Middle East. It will matter in northern Alaska. It'll matter in Greenland. People will cheer. People will make money. But it won't shift the global balance of petroleum. Gas is different. The amount of undiscovered gas in the Arctic is really big time. And it indicates to us that Russia will continue to be predominant from the point of view of gas resources in that part of the world. And finally, as I said earlier, in our view, most of these estimated resources are on the continental shelves, and they're not out in these international waters subject to the conventions of the law of the sea. If you are interested in this, I suggest the science article I mentioned earlier. Look at our website, the USGS website, or please, I encourage you to send me an email. I'd be happy to talk to you about it. Thank you very much.